As Kim has said that this is Isabel, thank you for your speech, that this is my first time traveling outside of Tanzania, and I can't, you know, when I was told that I was going to travel around to Australia, I was so very much excited, but when I was told that I would be coming to Hong Kong, I was nearly to burst with excitement. So when we landed there at the airport there, it was very hard to believe that I was in the same planet, though I had to ask Kim if we were in the same planet, because, and also Kim was working so quickly. But what did Kim need time to wander around all the things? Anyway, we wanted to be here in time, that's why Kim was working so quickly. So thank you guys, thank you for everyone who is here. So as I told you that this is my first time, you can see, you can just discover how excited I am, as you can see by yourself. So I'd like to tell you now a little bit about St. Jude's. The school St. Jude's, how long have I got, Kim?
You're probably about 5 minutes.
5 minutes, okay.
Now, I'm saying 5 minutes because that will cut it down to an hour and a half. This is Africa time.
Yeah. Okay, so as many of you know, that the school St. Jude started in 2002 with only 3 students, 1 teacher. And after only 11 years, St. Jude's is helping, you know, is giving free high-quality education to over 1,600 students from my country. This is so very much helpful, because the students who are getting free education at the school St. Jude's would not be able to attend a school at all. So we are so very much grateful for everyone who is supporting the school St. Jude. The founder of the school is Australian Gemma Sisia, who has been working very hard with, you know, her team of staff. That's why the school St. Jude is where it is today. Before I left there, the school St. Jude, because even the students, the staff, everyone was, you know, telling me, was surprised. Felix, who was just a bus driver, working as a visitor coordinator, is going to Australia to promote the school St. Jude. So the students, the staff, were telling me, Felix, please tell them we are very grateful for their support. So now, just make sure that you receive this one. Just shake hand to your neighbor, to the one who is standing next to you. This is thank you from the school of St. Jude family, okay? Because, thank you. So that is from St. Jude's family to say thank you for, you know, because, you know, that I'm here to promote the school, you know. I'm here to promote the school St. Jude and to tell more people about our fight against poverty, to tell people how your support has changed the life of so many people in Tanzania. The students of St. Jude's are very grateful for your support. And also, you know, in Tanzania, if you'd attend a government school in Tanzania, you'd have to go to a government school for more than 7 years, learning everything in Swahili in a class of over more than 100 students for 7 years. And if you are lucky enough to go to secondary school, everything is in English. So in Tanzania, if you're poor, you just remain poor because you don't have opportunity to attend private schools, which are, education is much better. So it used to be, if you're poor, you just go to government schools, which is very hard to go to secondary school. So St. Jude's is totally different. This is a special school, which is giving the opportunity to underprivileged students who didn't think that one day they would be able to attend a school like that. And the most important thing is, St. Jude's students, it is just, you know, it's not a normal thing in Tanzania that someone from so far can help you, you know, to pay for your school fee, to pay for your transport, for boarding facilities, without expecting to get something back. It used to be in Tanzania that if I help you, why don't you should come and stay in my family and help to, you know, washing, can water and things like that. Because St. Jude's students are getting support from people who are not related in any way, it's just by their love that they are supporting the school, St. Jude's students have also learned to help each other and the other students who are not St. Jude's for free without expecting to get something back. This is because we've got a feedback, because before I came here, I've done my own research how the community has been benefited from the school St. Jude. So the school St. Jude has been helping the students when they go, St. Jude students, when they go home during the holidays and during the weekends, because they are getting free high quality education as St. Jude's, when they go home, they ask their neighbors and their friends to come together. They teach them English. As I told you that in Tanzania, you go to a government school for more than 7 years, learning everything in Swahili. So when students get to class 5 and 6, they start thinking, how can they afford, how can they understand English when they go to secondary school? So what they do, their parents have to do contribution so that to help their children to understand English before they go to secondary school. So the teach parents have to contribute some money, so they get a teacher who English is not good enough, because the teacher has also passed it through the same system of education to teach the students English. They have to pay money. Not everyone can afford to contribute that amount of money. So now they don't have to think about that from my community, because St. Jude students, when they go home, they get a free education, they go home, they ask their neighbors, they ask their friends to come together, they teach them English for free. They can borrow books from St. Jude's, they can borrow other things which they can share with their neighbors and friends. This is so very much helpful, and everyone is appreciating. So when I tell you that I'm here to represent the community, everyone around there understands how the school St. Jude is changing the life of so many people over there. And also, we've got over 400 local staff who are working at the school St. Jude's. So those people could not have an employment without the school St. Jude being there. So we've got those people who are working there in different sections, teachers, and who are, you know. And also, not only Felix, who have got this opportunity to move from being a bus driver to the to now to visitor coordinator and now representing the school of St. Jude in Australia, but also I've got some people who have also moved from one step to another, because St. Jude is, you know, giving people the opportunity to move from one step to another. So this is so very much helpful. And I'd like to tell you a little bit. You want to talk to me? I would like to tell you a little bit about my story, which, because I started out as a bus driver. And I dressed this today especially because I'm this, you see, this is Sixori. Sometimes you can see me doing like this. This is, you know, when there is a ceremony, we go with this stick. And this is special thing that you use when there's some people who have done something special. For example, if, you know, we Maasai believe that all the cattle in the world belong to the Maasai. We believe that all the cattle were given to Maasai people by God. So cattle are more important than education in the Maasai society. So sometimes when people gonna bring cattle back, or, you know, there's like sometimes people can come and steal cattle, you know, the other from one place to another. So if boys go, the Maasai warriors go and bring cattle back, there's a ceremony, and this is the chief have to hold this one to congratulate, with also having meat ceremony that people have to eat meat. If the you bring cattle back, then they have to kill some cows for a ceremony. So this is, I don't mean that you have stolen cattle, but this is to say that we appreciate your support. So I'd like to tell you a little bit about myself, that I started out as a, you know, even before I went to school, as I told you that I'm from the very poor family. I attended a government school for 7 years, and my education was very, very hard, because I started school which I was 10 years old, because I had to wait until my uncle finished this school, then he could come and look after cattle. So because my father and grandfather wanted me to wait until my uncle could come and look after cattle, otherwise I would not be able to go to school. Then when he finished, I went to school, to a government school, which we were more than 250 students in my class. And my first class at that school, Leonie, you remember that school, was under the tree. So because we didn't have enough classrooms, so we were sitting under the tree. Because we were many students, over 250 students in one class, that class had to be split times two, because the half class should come in the morning and the other class in the afternoon. What do you think if your class would be under the tree, and what if it rains? No school. And because we did like school, you know, and also you should understand that that class was more than 250 students, one teacher under the tree. And we started there, we were writing on the floor. And if you could have, you could improve, then you can be given textbook. Otherwise, you keep always writing under the floor. It was very hard getting to school because the school was about 10 kilometers away. And sometimes you need, not sometimes, all every day, Monday to Friday, you need to be at the school before 7. And once you get there to school, you need to line up like this according to your class. And the other ones should come and line up depending which class you are. At 7 o'clock, the prefects will come and give you a number, your number, 1, 2, 3, depending how many will you be in your class. And then after that, you'll be doing cleanliness and stuff like that, and then you get in the class. The school finishes at 2:30. At 2:30, the teacher will come and say, if you didn't get a number in the morning, you were late. And if you were late, you'll be staying at school doing cleanliness, watering flowers, carrying water, which sometimes might be 5 kilometers away, and nothing to eat. You don't get breakfast, you don't get lunch. You stay there, just get 1 meal a day. So that was a lifestyle which I passed when I was a student. And I know our students have got the opportunity because most of our students are from that style of life. They live in that situation. So that time you go there, and sometimes you know, you wake up, you need to go to school in time, but your parents will tell you, make sure water is here, make sure you collect firewood, make sure you go and bring, look after kettle. And sometimes you might not go to school for 3 months because you'll be asked if there's no, for example, if it rains here and no rain at the other place. So we must, because cattle are more important than education, you bring cattle from another place here. 3 months, you'll be looking after cattle. After that, when you'll be looking after cattle there, no school. Until you go back there, you get time to go to school. So it's very hard. So I was there for class one, and then let me tell you when I was in standard 7, because I don't want to go through class 2 and 3 up there. But let me tell you class 7. In class 7, we were, you know, some of the students dropped out because of the difficulties of life and things like that. And when we were in class 7, the headmaster of our school had a meeting with all the parents, you know, to discuss how could they enable more students to go to secondary school for the first time. The decision was all the standard 7 students should stay at the educational camp for 3 months before their final examinations. And it was like that, and then the parents decided that, and they contributed some maize and beans for the student to eat when they stay at the camp. And we stayed there for 3 months, expecting that many students would pass for the first time to go to secondary school. When we did our final examinations, we were really looking forward for many students to go to secondary school for the first time. Unfortunately, when the results were out, only one student passed it to go to secondary school out of 250 students. It was very disappointing news. Parents were not happy with that. And then they were asking, what happened? They went to school, what happened? And then it was just found out that because the student, you know, the government may compose the examinations, the government marks the examination, but because no enough secondary school to send students, they just say only one student can pass from here. So they just discovered that there were no enough secondary school to take students, only one student out of 250. However, my father was determined for me to go to secondary school, because my grandfather didn't go to school at all. My father went to school up to class for 4 years only. He wanted me to go to school. However, he was not happy because I did not pass. So he found one of the schools at the where we are living. And finally, he got a school which was not good enough for me. And I went to that school for 4 years. However, my first year at the school, I was doing very well because, you know, because I was just from school, so I was doing very well. But in form two, when I got in form two at secondary school, because my father could not afford to pay for my school fee, as he was, my father was working at one of the, at one